According to Encyclopedia Britannica, fertility rate is the average number of children born to women during their reproductive years. The single most important factor in population growth is the total fertility rate, TFR. If on average women give birth to 2.1 children and these children survive to the age of 15, any given woman will have replaced herself and her partner upon death. A TFR of 2.1 is known as the replacement rate. The reason that it's 2.1 and not 2 is that the extra 0.1 accounts for higher probability of males born and mortality prior to the end of a person's fertile life. A rate greater than 2.1 will generally result in population growth, whereas a rate less than 2.1 will eventually result in population decline. Here is a map of global fertility rates as of 2020. Anywhere in dark green or any shade of blue is below replacement levels. These include most nations in Europe, Canada, Australia, Brazil, Russia, China, the United States, and many others. The lowest levels of fertility are found in developed parts of East and Southeast Asia, Singapore, Hong Kong, and South Korea, with South Korea having the lowest fertility rate in the world at 0.84. That's less than one child on average per woman. Countries shaded in yellow, red, and purple have higher than replacement level fertility, with Niger having the highest rate at 7.0. Higher fertility rates in developing countries reflect the need for children to engage in farming and other economic pursuits, as well as the lack of contraceptive access. According to OECD data, fertility rates have been falling significantly over the last few decades, with most developed countries now below replacement levels. People in developed countries are simply not having enough children to replace their populations. There are many reasons for this, but it is largely due to women's changing roles, employment shifts, and advances in reproductive health. In Korea, for example, more women are pursuing wealth and a higher standard of living rather than raising children. Both Japan and Korea now have declining populations. As the older generations start to die off, the younger generations are simply not having enough children to replace them. This has resulted in rapidly aging populations. According to the Australian Bureau of Statistics' latest release on births in Australia, we have a total fertility rate of 1.58, well below replacement level. For Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander women, the fertility rate is significantly higher at 2.25, which would ultimately result in population growth in the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander community if maintained. We can see in this graph that the fertility rate has dramatically fallen in Australia since the 1960s. Actually, it's been below replacement levels since 1976. Since 2010, the fertility rate has really started to fall, from 1.95 in 2010 to 1.58 in 2020. Australian women are turning away from motherhood, or at least turning away from large families. Despite this massive decline in fertility rate, why isn't Australia's population in decline? Actually, it's been significantly growing. One reason is population momentum. According to population education, one of the most common misconceptions about population growth is that a population stops growing once replacement level fertility is reached, a roughly two-child average. In fact, due to population momentum, a country's population can continue growing for another 70 years once replacement level fertility is reached. Here's an example from Wikipedia. Assume that a population has three generations, Gen 1, the oldest, Gen 2, those of childbearing age, and Gen 3, the children. Further assume that this population has a fertility rate equal to 4, that is, each generation is twice the size of the previous. If the population of the first generation is arbitrarily set at 100, the second is then 200, and the third is 400. That gives us a total initial population of 700, 100 plus 200 plus 400. Now assume that at the end of the third generation, fertility falls to replacement. For simplicity, let's assume that to be 2. Now take the population forward in time to the next generation. The first generation dies, and the new generation, Gen 4, is equal to the third, because now fertility is at replacement. We can repeat this process again to reach the fifth generation. The fifth generation is again equal to the fourth, and now the population's three generations are equal, and the population has reached equilibrium. The initial population has grown from 700 to 1200, even though fertility dropped from 4 to 2 at the end of the third generation. Population momentum carried the population to higher levels over the next two generations. So what's another reason why the population of Australia is still growing? I think many of us would already have guessed by now. Immigration. According to the ABS's latest release on migration, for the year ending 30th of June 2020, there were over 7.6 million migrants living in Australia. Almost 30% of Australia's population were born overseas. Australia is certainly an immigration nation. As we can see in this graph, in the last decade or so, Australia's net migration has been hovering around the 200,000 to 250,000 mark. People want to move to Australia. Of course, there has been much public debate about Australia's immigration rate. There's concerns around the environment, housing and infrastructure, employment, and social cohesion, just to name a few. Some people want more immigration, some people want less. Generally speaking, the government want more. Why? It's the economy, stupid. Sustained low fertility rates may signify a rapidly aging population, which may place an undue burden on the economy through increasing healthcare and social security costs. Australia needs explosive surge of 2 million migrants. Australia needs an explosive post-World War II style immigration surge that could bring in 2 million people over 5 years to rebuild the economy and address worsening labour shortages, according to New South Wales government advice. Opening Australia's borders is better for us all, RBA Governor Philip Lowe says. And here's some older stuff for you. In 2010, both major parties continued to support high immigration, with former Prime Minister Kevin Rudd advocating a big Australia, and opposition leader Tony Abbott stating in a 2010 Australia Day speech that, "My instinct is to extend to as many people as possible the freedom and benefits of life in Australia." On 7th of August 2018, the Australian Bureau of Statistics population clock reached 25 million, 33 years ahead of predictions, with 62% of the growth in the last 10 years being a result of immigration. However, in 2019, a Lowy Institute poll found that 49% of Australians say that the total number of migrants coming to Australia each year is too high, while a minority said it is too low, 13%, representing a 10-point rise in opposition to immigration since 2014. But basically, because there are economic benefits, and because there is a real risk of a shortage of working-age people to support an ageing population, governments will almost always push for an increase in population. And if the locals aren't having enough babies, the government will import the people instead. What do you think? Do we need population growth at all costs?